Hello, folks. Today I've got a short video for you showing off my most recent buildup of Polar Lights Jupiter 2. You know, that little saucer-shaped ship from the classic TV show Lost in Space. There you can see the engine pod lit up. You can see that it's nice and bright, despite the fact that the model is very brightly lit at the moment. The circuit board driving those LEDs is powered by a 9-volt battery, which is located inside the display base that the Jupiter is sitting on top of. While I'm on the subject of powering up this model, all the interior lighting is powered by an 8-volt AC-DC adapter. The engine pod, the overhead lights, and the console computer panels are all operated by individual on-off switches located on the side of the display base. The overhead lights inside the cabin are powered directly from the 8-volt DC power supply. Well, the control consoles and the cryo-tubes and the computer wall panel and all the animated lighting inside the ship is driven by chaser boards. In fact, there are 4 individual chaser boards installed to allow me to have slightly different speeds and different patterns for each of the items that I wanted to animate inside the ship. Notice, as long as we're looking at the bottom of the Jupiter at this point, you might notice that there are no wires showing. And if I took the time to turn it around, which I'm not going to, you wouldn't see any wires in the back either. Since all the circuitry for the ship is inside the Jupiter 2 hull, and since all the power connections and on-off switches are in the display base, I needed a way to run the wires from the circuit boards inside the ship down inside the display base, without having them dangling out and, you know, giving the Jupiter 2 a serious case of ugly. Well, that wasn't as hard as it sounds, actually. I simply drilled out each of the 3 landing legs. The wiring from the circuit boards is all combined into a single pair of wires, and the wiring for the overhead lights inside the ship are another pair of light wires, and there's a separate set of wires for the engine pod lights, and so that's one set of wires running through each of the 3 landing legs. And as you can see, it looks very nice and neat, and nothing shows. So if you're planning on trying to build your own Jupiter 2 and you want a way to conceal your power supply and add an on-off switch and things like that without having to stuff everything inside the Jupiter and power everything by batteries, take a shot at drilling out those landing legs. It works very nicely. The second lighting feature I added to the Jupiter 2 model was the overhead lighting inside the flight cabin. This consists of 2 sections of LED strip lighting, with one located on either side of the port for the clear dome on top of the ship. These 2 strips are 12-volt LEDs connected directly to the 8-volt DC power supply, and they provide a good amount of light inside the ship. In fact, here's what that looks like from outside the ship. And just to make it a little clearer, let's turn off the exterior lighting here. There we have it. You can see that's pretty bright. Now, the same on-off switch that controls the overhead lighting also controls the LED that I installed in the navigation console that's at the center of the Jupiter 2's flight deck. That LED is a 12-volt car headlight LED, and like the overhead lighting, it's connected directly to the 8-volt power supply. As you can see, that kicks out an awful lot of light all by itself, making the inside of the cabin very nice and bright. Very nice and bright indeed. In fact, it provides so much light that I didn't have to do any separate lighting for the exterior dome on top of the ship. The LED in the navigation console just pumps its light straight up and out that overhead dome. So I didn't have to run any extra wires or add any extra LEDs to light that up. The next lighting feature I added to the Jupiter 2 was animated lighting in the cryo-tubes. Each tube is lit by a very bright 5mm LED, and when those are in operation, the interior lighting looks a little different from outside the ship. Kind of like that, in fact. Well, that should give you a pretty good idea of what the ship's lighting looks like from the outside of the Jupiter 2. Now let's take a quick look at the lighting effects inside the ship. Here we have the flight control station where the pilot and co-pilot sit. And to spiff up the interior a little bit, I cut away the lumpy blocks that were supposed to be the seats in the original Polar Lights kit and replace them with those two individual pilot seats for a more slightly more authentic look. And here we have the navigation console at the center of the ship. And a quick look at the very back of the ship. We've got the detailed out hatches, the elevator cage, and over here on the other side we have the tops of a couple of cryo tubes peeking over the walls. Now the back of this ship is kind of dull compared to the front because there's no lighting features back there at all. All right, moving on, we come to the cryo tubes. As you can see, instead of painting the top of the tubes silver, I covered them in metal tape. This gives a nicer, shinier finish, and it's completely lightproof so that when the tubes are lit, there's no light leaking through the top of the tubes. The lighting for each tube consists of a single bright blue 5mm LED. Each LED was prepared by cutting the rounded tip off, then sanding the top of the LED flat. All right, let's get a quick look at how these things look lit up. As you can see, even with the room lights on, these tubes light up very brightly. They not only light up themselves, they do a good job of lighting up the wall panels behind them. And I think you can see why I used the metal tape, because it doesn't let any light come through. What you're seeing on top is light that's being reflected from one tube to the next. And without room lighting, it looks like this. Now we come to the flight control station. Now, lighting those cryo tubes was fairly simple. Lighting the command consoles was a little more complicated. The animated lighting in the consoles is a combination of 2mm LEDs and a lot of fiber optic strands. Now the black vertical sections at the front of the control console, the parts that are standing straight up, those are lit by 3 2mm LEDs stuck straight in from the underside of the control console. Each one of those three sections has 3 LEDs in it. The radar screens are also lit by LEDs. The radar screen on the far left and the radar screen on the far right are lit by a single green LED that is controlled by a chaser board and simply flashes. The control console in the center has that three-part screen, so it's lit by 3 separate LEDs, a red one, a blue one, and I think a yellow one. And those are also connected to a chaser board so that they can sort of move around and take turns lighting up that screen. Now all the other lighting on these control panels is 0.5 millimeter colored fiber optic. Now the nice thing about having pre-colored fiber optics is that you don't have to worry about what color your LEDs are. The chaser board that controls the lighting on these consoles has nothing but white LEDs in it. So, since the fibers themselves are colored, the white light gives you all the brightness and all the color that you need. And here's what it looks like. Okay, I think that gives you an idea of what the control consoles look like when they're lit up. Now let's move on, and the next thing that got lit was the monitor station set on the right of the control consoles. As you can see, that simply flashes blue and red, blue and red. But since it's driven by a chaser board, it sometimes alters its flashing pattern. Now it looks like we've got a red alert going on here or something, since it's just flashing in red. I suppose I could have run some additional fiber optic into this area and lit up more of that console also, but I decided to keep this bit very simple. All right, here we have the computer wall. On the far right of this section of wall, of course, we have the super high-tech computer tape drive. Woo! When was the last time any of us saw one of those in real life? In the center of this wall, of course, is that navigation system, which I assume is some sort of gyro stabilizer or something. And, of course, on the far left, we have the Irwin Allen Special, the wall of flashing squares. And when I light it up, that computer section looks like this. Now, of course, it's obvious the LEDs that are driving that board are hooked up to a chaser circuit. And each of those individual dots of light that you see coming on and going off, each one of those is the tip of a strand of clear fiber optic. There are 54 strands of fiber optic to correspond to the 54 squares on the board. Now, some of them don't seem to be lined up with the square they belong in. That's mostly due to the camera angle at the moment. The chaser boards that I use for these types of projects have two very nice control features. One is that I can change the speed at which the lights chase around. This board is currently running at the slowest possible speed. The other thing that can be changed is that this particular board comes with 16 different lighting patterns. I chose to leave the board in what the manufacturer calls demo mode, which means it is simply going to cycle through all of its different lighting patterns, which produces this very nice sort of random light show where the patterns on the computer panel keep changing. Very nice Irwin Allen-esque kind of effect. And there it goes. I'm going to let this run for a few seconds and you'll get to see some of the different patterns that come up. Got to admit, this seemingly random lighting pattern is certainly more interesting than simply having those LEDs scroll from left to right and left to right and left to right all the time. Looks like we're having problems again. There we go. We're back to normal. You know, what would an Irwin Allen show be without the computer panel going batso once in a while? There we go. Anyway, I think that gives you a pretty good idea of what the lighting effect on the computer wall looks like. And that pretty much covers all of the lighting inside the Jupiter 2, or at least my model of the Jupiter 2. like I said, it's, you know, it's not terribly sophisticated, but considering the size of the Polar Lights model, I think it came out pretty well. The new Mobius model in 1/35th scale, of course, has a lot more room in there, and you can do a lot more sophisticated lighting if you want to. It's a lot easier to get into a lot of the tighter places that I didn't bother lighting at all. But considering the size of the Polar Lights kit, I think this looks pretty cool. Now let's take a break from all this bright flashy stuff and take one last look at the outside of the ship. Well folks, that about concludes my Jupiter 2 model presentation. I hope you enjoyed watching this little video as much as I enjoyed putting this Jupiter 2 together. Like I said, the lighting wall is not the most sophisticated that you'll see in a YouTube video, but I like it. It works. Thank you for watching. Have a great day. Bye.